our institution. I mean, even ourselves in our time. It's only after years that we discovered, and this is, by the way, before Global Forum, that we were getting data from Australia.
Yeah.
It would come through on tapes, but it would just lie there. So, it is only when, just before the start of the Global Forum, that we started to fix these things up, to regularize these things, the appointment of competent authorities, and have the necessary capability in place to analyze the data. As you know already with the Panama data, you can get data and you may not be able to do much with it. But that's the start of a process. So it may be that the data that we'll be getting is not enough. It may be that the other party is not compliant. But until we have the capability to go through those things, to deal with those things, you wouldn't be able to make an informed, you wouldn't be able to take an informed view of exactly what must be. Now there's a last point there that's very, very important, especially when it comes to transfer price. You can get away with most other things in having the tax technical knowledge. As a tax authority, you might be able to deal with it. But when it comes to transfer pricing, the people involved in it have got to have a good understanding of the business as a whole. You need to have that domain knowledge. And you may need, depending on the size of the institution, to actually perform dedicated capabilities for particular sectors. Like it might mean in South Africa, should have a dedicated capability to deal with the mining. So,
look, what we try, not when I say we, I'm really saying PG tried to do, and he's bigger time. Over time, since around about 98, 99, was to develop within SARS a capability, to handle large businesses. We had the large business center. It came through an evolution from around about 2004. We had an enormous number of people, of highly skilled people in that. Now, what is not well known, but it's there in most tax statistics, is that 80% of all corporate income tax in South Africa is collected from only about 400 companies. Only about 400 companies. And on our register, we have thousands and thousands of owners, thousands and thousands of other companies. Now they bring in company income tax only about 20%. So for a long time, therefore, and a huge amount of effort went into understanding those 400 companies. Even at the height of the LBC,
what is that?
The large business center, sorry. We still could never match the corporate tax offices, nor the strength, you know, the capacity they can draw still from law firms and accounting firms. Which is why you will have noticed that PG always made a huge effort in persuading people that tax is the right thing to do.
PG being Pravin
Gordhan. Sorry.
Inside the speak.
Yeah. And his IP.
Is that intellectual property?
So there was a huge amount of effort to change the mindset about tax morality, because even if we employed all the accountants, all the lawyers, and all the engineers, they would still build three times our capacity. It wasn't just a morality call. Okay, there were many other things that that were done at that time. Okay, if, for instance, we found a scheme, I'll make an example that is always that was also there, in the public. We found cases in the electronics industry where people had what is called the gray goods and all of those things. We would hammer the biggest one and put all the resources in that. And when the rest of the others could see that we are capable of doing that, then we would call in the whole industry and say, this is what you're doing, one, two, three. And many of them generally didn't want to face us again. So there was a lot of creativity that went into it. We made ourselves look bigger than we actually were. And we, as I said, attracted quite a bit of, a huge amount of the accounting profession was going through SARS, so were lawyers. I mean, our legal department had about 800 lawyers. It was just our legal department. Accountants were everywhere. And we had a design division that worried about the processes within SARS, which we call the EBE, Enterprise Business Enablement, which had 380 engineers. So a huge amount went into building that capacity at that time. As things stand, the transfer pricing team at SARS resigned en masse in 2015. The indirect tax team resigned en masse 2015. The enforcement division has been collapsed, and some of us were kicked to the curb. So much of what, I'm forgetting another important section, which you will never see, is called the risk engine. The people who just worry about the data as it comes in and make the adjustments and say this is risky and all of that, it has a huge number of statisticians in it. Look at they left with us at the time, just end of 2014 and end of 2015.
So how many people in total left?
The number, according to the commissioner, when he answered a parliamentary question around about April 2016, 55. Between then and now, I don't know.
Let me just touch on a few things. Even when we were there, even when we succeeded in attracting some very good professionals, it's very difficult to keep. So never mind the actual problems that SARS are having now. It's very, very difficult to keep the professionals. Because we had developed a good reputation, because we were doing some good and interesting work, they wanted to come. But they wanted to come for a while, and they wanted to have our name on their resumes and their CVs. So they would come 2-3 years and leave. So actually there is, what is actually required is that this is a reality you have to accept. There will be a small number that will stay with you for a long time, but that's because they identify with your values. The others will come and go. And I think the human resource model has got to accept that. That's how it is. And in fact, it might be a good thing, because you're going to get newer people who come in with newer experience and newer ideas. But that's part of the difficulty of having a top-notch team. The two other points that are there, the mid-sized companies, the judge raised that question. Now, in SARS, we focus on the large business center. But in the last year, around 2014, we began to look at the mid-sized companies. And the judge is quite right. It's an important sector to look at. These are the companies that are sort of below the limelight. They are not noticed by most people. And it is quite a big sector. And it's an important source of revenue. We had just begun segmenting this mid-sized company. I don't know what progress is being made on. Then the trusts. I want to remind you again of what I said at the beginning. We really have got to get a good understanding of what is happening in public administration. It's very difficult to get on top of the trust from a tax point of view, because the trust administration itself is in such poor shape. Trusts are kept in the master's offices, distributed throughout the country, and most of these offices, these are still in paper files. And maybe I'm doing them an injustice, but what people are doing is that they have paper funds. I don't believe that anybody is actually managing the trusts in terms of what are their compliance with trust laws. I'm not even talking about tax laws. We had begun a process in about 2013, I think.
Yeah.
It just started working together with CIPC and working together with Stats SA. And working together with the Master's Office to see how we could try and help the situation. What we were doing simultaneously also is trying to work with Home Affairs and CIPC. What we were saying is this: when it comes to South Africa, at the core to managing the identities of South Africans, whether it's companies or individuals, it's Home Affairs, it's SARS, it's CIPC, that are the cornerstone, and the trust, that are the cornerstone. That we needed to bring integrity into that process. Everything else rests on that. If that's not clean, you will have continuous problems. I mean, even today, some insurance companies, if you cite your ID number, they actually try to check if your ID number is the correct one.